Thank you, IFA, for putting this together. I am excited to share whatever I have sort of gathered over the last few months, few years, especially the last few months, because lockdown has really, helped us explore so much more. So here it is. So let's start. I'm going to be presenting a few slides. We'll go over them one after the other. And at the end of the presentation, we will have a quick Q&A. And if there is something that you want to share, something you want to ask, please feel free. And to the best of my knowledge, I definitely put out the answers that I know. Like I told you, we are still exploring. So I really can't consider myself an expert in this. It's only whatever little I know, I'm trying to share with all of you. So here we go. Okay, so I would like to start. 1 second. Okay, yeah. Okay. So, as we are all dancers, musicians present here, I'm sure all of you know about Natya Shastra. In Natya Shastra, Bharata Muni has spoken about four kinds of expression: Angika, Vachika, Aharya, and Satvika. So for some of you who might not know, I'll just keep it very short. Angika is expression through bodily movements. Vachika is expression, communication through speech, music, all of this. Aharya's expression through the embellishments, the costumes, the makeup, the stage set design, lighting, all of this. And Satvika is, we are talking here about the psychological state which is being communicated. So you might be wondering why I have started about speaking about Natya Shastra in a workshop about digital space. So my take is this: had Bharata Muni existed today, had he written Natya Shastra today, he would have added another important chapter to his work, and he would have called it Ankikam. Ankika means the digital world. Okay, it has become such an important aspect for all of us today. All the work that we do finally ends up in the digital space one way or the other. And that has been, it's been enhanced in the last few months with social distancing in place. And we don't know when we are going to enter an auditorium or a performance area to perform, entertain our audiences, which we don't know. And with that in place, the digital environment has really come together. Okay, it is providing a lot of options to us. Please hold on, there's some issue. See, this is what happens with the digital world, you see. So we have to get used to this. Yeah. And let's talk about the ecosystems. So these are all the terms that we have been looking at, hearing, and we are also speaking them, right? Live, comments, stacks, performance, learning, webinar, conference, teaching, tech, camera. So we have a camera person here with us, a photographer, Sudhi. He was talking about his work, how his work can actually affect us and help all the performing artists. Now I think all the work is speaking through the camera. It's become such an important aspect of all our performances. So this really is our ecosystem. And keeping these things in mind, how do we use them? Whatever we are speaking today, whatever I'm going to be communicating today is something that all of us are already doing. We are only going to look at a few aspects. If we put into practice, it will make our experience, it will make the experience for the audiences a little more better. We can have effective communication. So that's what we are going to be talking about today. So coming to the next aspect, which is the devices, basic devices that we need to be in the digital space, to put out our work and make a statement in the digital space. We know these already, right? We laptop, our tablets, and cell phones. You might have noticed here, I'm putting 1, 2, and 3 here. This is an order of preference, especially for something like a webinar, conference, all of this. I would always suggest viewing it and conducting it on a laptop. It is a much more stabler device. Then comes, of course, our tablet. And the last is a handheld smartphone. Of course, we will later in the presentation, we will talk about the importance of the smartphone itself, how that becomes a key factor in creating our performances. Now, going further, with respect to the laptop and the tablet, this is the position that we should really be looking at. What happens is, majority of the time, the person who's looking at the device is either above or below. I would always suggest that the camera in the device should be at eye level. So this is important. We have to consider this. In fact, we can do a little exercise right away. So I'm stopping share. Some of us, if you see, if you notice, we are either looking at our devices like this. See, like this. You see, this is happening, or from below. Yeah, there is a difference. On the other hand, what is ideal is to really keep it at eye level. So let's start the practice. We're all, you know, artists, we practice our, you know, speech. So it will be great if you can adjust your devices. Let's start with that. If you find, you know, you can keep a few books to support your device, raise it up, do whatever you can to do. Okay, that's possible. So if you can do that, that's really good. So this is one of the first things that we are going to be learning today. And also this helps when we teach class, you know, especially dancers. I see many of my colleagues and my friends who place their devices on the floor so that their entire frame is covered. It's a valid point, but it's somehow for the student, it looks a little odd, to look at their teacher or the instructor from this perspective. So it's still better if we are able to keep the device at eye level. So it is going to be helpful. Let me continue with the slide share now. So by the way, I'm going to be making you all do a couple of things like this. So please don't mind. Yeah. Next. About the phone. It is always better to use a tripod to place your phone. So this is particularly helpful when we go live on Facebook, Instagram, etc. from our phones itself. So please do, it's a small investment. I'm sure all of you have a tripod. If not, please get one. It's not going to cost much. If you are using a phone, please use tripod. There is going to be much more stability. The images won't shake. Okay, and also it will give you enough and more, even if you want to pan and things, you want to move the camera, move the phone itself, you can use the tripod. It is much, much better. Yeah. And these are some of the things that we really need as basic devices. Bluetooth speaker, earphone, headphone, mics. Okay, we will speak about this in detail. The most important along with all this is what is going to appear now. Wi-Fi. If you don't have this, sorry, we are not going to be able to showcase anything at all. We have come to that state right now. It is, please, if you can create your projects from a place where there is a high bandwidth, okay, a super fast internet connection. So these become our basic devices. Okay, and also coming to the Wi-Fi, there are two things. Let's say you don't have a strong connection and you're doing something outside. So the phone 4G hotspot is really good. We can use it also. And that can also be kept as a backup, even if you're doing something in a studio space or from your homes. So please do always keep a backup, especially for the Wi-Fi. Now we will look at a few video conferencing platforms. Today I'm dividing my presentation into three sections. The first section, we are going to be talking about video conferencing platforms that can be used for teaching, for creating workshops, interviews, conferences, those. The second will be putting out our work, our performances itself. And we'll also be touching upon creating conferences that can be streamed onto our Facebook and YouTube and other platforms. So these are the three aspects that we'll be covering. So to begin with, the teaching modules. Video conferencing platforms, here a few have been mentioned. Beyond this, there are many. Okay, these are some things that I thought are important, that are really good platforms, so which is why I've mentioned them here. Zoom, of course, we know we are already on Zoom, and most of us know how to use Zoom. Then along with that, we also have Google Meet. So now most of us have our Gmail accounts. And Gmail has enabled Google Meet in our Gmail account itself. So we can use it. And again, that is free of cost. Google Meet at the moment is free of cost till I think September, if I'm not wrong. And Zoom does have a basic account, which is free of cost. But there are some aspects, if you want them, then you'll have to go for the premium account, the pro account. Similarly with the Cisco WebEx, that's also a good platform. They do have a free availability as well. And of course, with add-ons, they charge you something. Then we have BlueJeans. This is one of the most popular platforms that is used in Europe and the US. They're also very good. And Microsoft Teams. This to me has been very, very good. Their features are improving every day, and it's a completely free software at the moment. And several institutions, I'm talking about huge institutions, several schools have got onto Teams and they're running their classes. I'm talking about our regular schools. They have got onto Teams and they are conducting classes. So these are some fantastic conferencing platforms. And like I told you, all of them are free to begin with. So we can always try out, explore, and see what we are comfortable with. And then really, choose the platform that we are going to work with. So today we will be discussing the Zoom in detail, because that's also become one of the most popular softwares that, especially in India, that all of us have started using since the lockdowns. And one more good thing is, of course, there were some security concerns and things, but the company has been working on it. I've been getting notifications. Several features have improved. So we will look into the basics of Zoom and the basics of Teams for today. Okay. So Zoom, how to create a meeting. I think majority of us know what this is. As soon as you go, this is a landing page. We can schedule a meeting. There's a link that is available and that can be shared. As soon as you schedule. So here I've just given an example of, I've scheduled a Kathak class for myself. So that was from 4:30 to 5:15, and we have a meeting ID. And as the host of the meeting, you can start. So this is what this says. If you go further, you get this once you schedule the meeting. Here, as you can see, it says password, require meeting password. This is very important. As a security measure, please keep this on. A password is generated, and when you send it to your students, your participants of the workshop, please send it along. Please send the password along, and they'll be able to access the meeting only with the password. This is basically a very, very good security measure, and which all of us must and should follow. And not just that, there are other few options that I'm sure which you can try out, like keeping the video of the host on and participants on, of all those things. What I want to talk about is another security measure. If you go down, there is an advanced options here. You click on that and this appears. Here in the advanced options, we find something called enable waiting room. Please tick this. In fact, even when we came into this meeting, as the one that we are attending right now, IFA had enabled the waiting room. This is very important. So we know that only the people who we want are entering our meeting. So please do keep these things enabled. And then of course you schedule and send the details and you can start your meeting. When I say meeting, I'm talking about a classroom or a workshop as well. Coming to other video settings. So here we see, there are two things that I want to talk about here. As soon as you open camera here, you'll see an integrated webcam. This is when you use Zoom from a laptop. So automatically the webcam switches on and it takes the input from there. I will be speaking about this aspect in detail in my next session, 2 weeks from now, where we can add other devices which will act as a webcam. So we don't really have to choose to use the webcam that the device comes with. The reason being, our laptops and tablets, the webcam that is there, are not really of high quality. We can really use a proper DSLR and a proper video cam that can be used as a webcam for this device. That's also possible. We will talk about that setting in my next session. Today, we are only touching upon the basics. Another thing that you can see here is mirror my video. So this, I think, is an important aspect in my opinion. So for example, I'm going to stop the share here. So for example, I'm teaching dance. All of us who teach dance, for example, when we let's say I just do my tatkara, my hand movements in Kathak. So if I want to do ta, te, te, tat, and a, te, te, tat, for example, generally in a physical classroom, I would mirror. Okay, I would do the opposite. If I want my students to do the right, I would do my left. So I would start off with ta, te, te, ta, and a, te, te, for example. Okay, so what this does is, this particular feature, this mirroring does is, while you are running the class, you are also visible to your, you know, in your screen. Okay, so if I'm doing this and my device shows me doing it the opposite side, it's confusing. Okay, so it is confusing for me. Again, each of the teachers, they have a different way to, you know, approach this. This mirror option helps you sort of, you know, navigate that. The output remains the same for the students. Output remains the same. The output doesn't change. This is only for yourself. That's it. Okay, it's only for yourself. So we'll continue with the share. So this is what the, you know, I thought is important as musicians and dancers. Now, coming to screen share. In my opinion, this is very, very important for all artists, a great tool that we can use in our classes. So here, as we start, here is a screenshot I have taken. You find this option, this green option here, which says share screen. So when you do this, and also right next to it is a record button, so you can also record your classes, okay, and share it with the students later, or even for, you know, analysis and, you know, just to archive, you can use it. So right now we'll be speaking about screen share. If you click on this green button, this window appears. So this window basically has all the other applications you have opened on your laptop before starting Zoom. So this is a screenshot where I took off, you know, this, the first one is the screen, you know, the Zoom itself appears. Then below that is a PPT. Then we have the Chrome, another folder that I had opened, and here is another Word document, I think. Yeah. So these were all the things that I had opened when I took the screenshot. So I can choose one of them. Let's say I have created lesson notes, and this is maybe this one, this window is that. I click on this and then I say share, and that particular window gets shared, like how I'm sharing the PPT right now with all of you. Also, if you see here right below, there are two components, okay, two options. One says share computer sound. The second one says optimize screen sharing for, screen sharing for video clip. If you want to share audio clips and video clips in your classroom, please tick them so that the settings are configured for that. And then you press the share button. And another option is, whatever we saw before was the basic options. There's also an advanced, okay? When you go to the advanced, these three things appear. One is portion of a screen. If you click on this, you will be able to zoom in to a particular aspect. Okay, so let's say in the slide that you're showing, you want to show only one part of the slide. That can be done through this portion of screen. Second, music or computer sound, we have already spoken about this. You can play files. Music files can be played. Content from second camera. This again, we will speak in detail in my next session, because here we are talking about connecting your laptop to another camera, an external camera, and showing things from that. Yeah. Now, apart from this, lesson notes. So this is a lesson notes created by Sai Tejas, who also joined us in the meeting for his harmonica workshop. Ideally, you know, in a physical class, we would have asked our students to write. You know, we would have dictated and they would have written. Here what we can do is we can create these PDFs and we can share the notes. Here students can look at this and play. So here, you know, I'm sure Tejas was teaching Twinkle Twinkle Little Star, the rhyme, with the notations. So he's also very, cleverly bifurcated it. The Sahitya is in red and the Swaras are in black. So, you know, with this, it's very helpful for students. They can look at it and play. So things like these can be achieved. On the other hand, let's say, as artists, not everything is so well planned, right? We can create notes to some extent. What if we have decided and what we want to do something on the go? Then here we have an option. Again, in the basics, when you do the share, you find something called the whiteboard. You click on this and do the share, and this appears, this window appears. Here you can draw, you can write, you know, all these things are possible. And let's say, for example, in my class, I was teaching a Tihai, and I had not really prepared a PDF file of that to share with my students. So what I can do is, I'll go to this. I'll write this. Ta thei thei tat, a thei thei tat, thi ta thei. I can write something like this, and it's easier. Not just writing. So there are, like you see, draw options, stamps, spotlight, so many things. You can really play with it. Okay, these options are fantastic, especially when we are teaching in class. Now, pointers. Recording sessions for analysis, archives, and sharing. Like I told you, the record button is there, and we can use it very effectively. Also, there is an option to, in the pro version, there is an option where we can record it and share it with our students, put it on our cloud, put it on YouTube, unlisted channel, so many things that can be done. On the other hand, because we are running all our classes online, it will be really good if you also start creating audio and visual aid as a supplementary resource. This can be shared with our students, you know, online and through WhatsApp. So this is something that they can refer to. Next, coming to the managing, coming to the lag, I like to see in Zoom classes, in all these online classes, there is always a lag. It is never happening in real time. There is a few seconds lag that happens. So especially with dance and music. So what I would always suggest is, like how we are doing right now, to make sure the students are on mute. So we instead, let's say we sing the particular song, or the composition, or maybe dance the particular part, or recite for it so that the students can listen to it and dance. So if we keep everybody on unmute, the sound is going to be jarring and they'll all be listening to each other. It'll be very disturbing. So that is one thing. On the other hand, how do you listen to them, especially in a music class? This has to be, I don't know, I have not found a better option for this. We will have to do it on a case-by-case manner. We'll have to look at, unmute every person, make them recite or make them play, sing, etc. Give feedback. We'll have to do it this way in an online class. If there is a better way, if somebody has tried, please do share with me. I'll also be more than happy to listen to that. Yeah. So these are some pointers that we should be, definitely keep in mind when it comes to using online platforms for teaching and creating, conducting workshops. We'll go to Teams. Again, this is the only slide I have for Teams. The reason being, again, it's very, very simple to use. The best part about Teams is, I'm talking about Microsoft Teams. This is the other video conferencing software. We can create these multiple standards and classrooms. If you have to consider a school, there'll be, 7th, 8th, 9th, 10th. So I can create an entire channel just for the 7th. And in 7th, let's say there is section A, B, C. I can create channels inside that. So for example, if my team, I've just created one here. It says Kathak JP Nagar. If that is one of my teams, under that, I have my intermediate as well as my advanced. So I can create multiple channels in one team. So similarly, music beginners and so on and so forth. So this is especially helpful for institutions. Let's say a cultural organization runs, classes for Bharatanatyam, classes for music, classes for Kathak, classes for drawing. All that can be managed from one software. So we can create these teams. The different teachers can be moderators for each of them, and students can come in only to their classes at that time, and we can go, we can run them. So that way it's very helpful. And also Teams, this is the latest feature in Teams, which is why I just put it here. Till about a week back, this feature was not there. Schedule a meeting, like how we do in Zoom, we were not able to schedule a meeting in advance. So now they have done that as well. It's very simple. We can try this out, and it is a free software, so which is great for all of us. Now, coming to audio settings. Here, we want to talk about three aspects. One is the selection of the room. When I say audio settings and selection of room, so we really need to think through this from the place from where we are conducting our classes, especially for music and dance. It's very important. Music, the music itself plays such an important role, and we need to keep this in mind because the delivery is very important as well. Please select a room with less echo, then away from the road or any other source of constant noise. So that is one thing we'll have to keep in mind. And the third point is having non-reflective surfaces around the device. What do we mean by non-reflective surfaces? So for example, a concrete wall is a reflective surface. Sound waves bounce off it. On the other hand, a cushion is a non-reflective surface. It really doesn't reflect sound as highly or as badly as a concrete wall, which is why when we go to recording studios, we see that the soundproofing is done with wood, with foam, and all of this. So we need to figure out that. And one might ask, how do we achieve this at home? It is possible. You know, we have cushions, we have curtains, you know, pillows. We can keep that around and reduce the echo to the best possible extent. Okay, so these are some things that we can do with things at home. Now, I want to give an example. Play two tracks. It is the same bowl which I have recited. One was recited in a room in my house where the echo is more because because the space was empty. On the other side, the second track will be the same bowl which I have recited from a room which is little better in terms of the acoustics. So please listen to it. That was the first track, and now we go to the second track. You might have noticed, I'm sure all of you are wearing your earphones, there is this slight difference. Okay, I was not using the mic at all. By the way, there is no power here. This is something that we have to speak about as well. Okay, we have to have power backup, especially when we are doing things online. Thankfully, I have a modem for my Wi-Fi, so that is still working and the session is continued. Like you say, I'm already, you know, right now I'm in a setup where there is natural light. You see, on this side, there is some light hitting my face and there's some light hitting my face from this side. But this is not an ideal setup for me. I wouldn't want to be here, right? So this is exactly what we're going to be talking in my next slide. So I hope that audio example was so sort of gave you an idea of how we can do things. Okay, we'll continue with my slides. Now, coming to our audio settings. So background music, Bluetooth speakers, and external mics. These are three things that I have mentioned here. Background music, all of us as dancers and musicians, we need something. For example, if I'm running a Kathak class, I would definitely want to have my lehra on. Okay, how do we achieve this? The best thing is, I had mentioned about devices that are needed, right, to run these things, Bluetooth speaker. So what you can do is you connect your phone from which the lehra is played to your Bluetooth speaker. That is a separate thing. Yeah. And that is captured by the device's mic or an external mic. And the students will be able to hear that. Similarly, even for musicians, let's say a karaoke track is being played on which you want your students to sing or play another instrument. A similar methodology can be adopted. Now, coming to the other side of it, how you want to hear your students. It'll be again ideal if your device, this is especially for all the musicians out here, it'll be great if you can connect your laptop from which you're running the classroom to a speaker so that what the students are playing is heard very clearly by you. You can correct them about the nuances and things like that. And also for musicians, I think it's very, very important to have an external mic. So for example, here it is. I'm right now using a lapel mic, an external mic. This is something that's easily available. We can connect it. We don't need a mixer. We don't need any of that. This is not something like, it's not a mic which is used in events, right, which comes with, its own other devices. This can be directly connected to your phone or your laptop. Yeah. So this is something I'm sure this is an important tool for all the musicians out here. No doubt about it. And even for dancers. I know the reason I'm not stressing on dancers is most of the time we are out there dancing along with the students, right? So in that case, what we can do is now there are Bluetooth mics that are available. I'm getting notifications about it on my Instagram page every day. A sponsored, there's something called Carol Tech mic or something. I forget the name. So Bluetooth mics are also available. If that is there, great. Dancers can use it as well. Yeah. Then we'll continue. Lighting. So like I told you, this is something that I really want to talk about today. Face the light, light the face. So a classic example that I already gave you. Initially I was in an ideal setup. There was light on my face. I was very happy. I think the electricity board in Bangalore did not like it. The power is off now and I'm back to my natural setting. So, sun god is helping me to some extent right now. If this is the case, if this is the case, I will have to turn my face towards the light. That is what is going to give me the best effect possible. Also, here there are two examples. On the left, if you see, you see a photo of mine. It is the same place. There is backlight. Okay, do you see some light spilling from behind? And that immediately reduces the clarity. On the other hand, on the image in the right side, I'm still sitting in the same place. I have covered the light with a curtain. And the clarity is much, much better. This is something we really have to consider. Here, of course, it's an example of natural light. Even in a room where our other bulbs and our lights are on, please make sure there is no light switched on the wall behind you. Let the lights always be in front of you. Okay. Also, the main reason being the device cameras that we are using are not of great quality. They can't capture low light. Okay. So we really have to keep this in mind. Use of natural light. Like I told you, if there is no other source and you have to use natural light, please turn towards the light. Unless you are creating some experimental work where you want the sun behind you. Okay. But in all normal circumstances, please do make sure you're turning towards the light. And utilizing household lights effectively. We don't really need pro lights to do these things. You know, there are so many lampshades, there are bulbs that we have in the house. Arrange them in such a way that light falls on you. Okay. The next part being pro lights, we will speak about pro lights in detail in my next session. Okay, not in the basic session today for sure. Okay. Now, I want to do a small exercise with all of you. We've all looked at the lights, right? Of course, I'm in a very bad shape right now to give an example myself live. Thankfully, I had those two images and you were able to see what I wanted to convey. Some of you can look at yourself in this meeting. Light is not falling on you. Can you rearrange yourself? Yes, Sudhi has a great idea there. He switched on his flashlight and he's kept it up on top. Fantastic. Yes. Okay, I have another example, classic example with Ramya. As Ramya was turning, okay, can you please go back, Ramyaji? Can you please turn to go the other side? I lost her. Okay, I think she'll come back. She'll switch on her. Yes, here. Did you see something? Is that a mirror, Ramyaji, if I'm not wrong? It is, yeah. Okay, you see this? There is no light actually there. Okay, but the mirror has captured the light. This is something that we will not want. Okay, so basically any source of light at the back is definitely not helpful. Yeah, and also, okay, I'm sorry I'm picking on you again. Ramyaji, I'm going to pick on you again. The reason being, I can see some light on the wall behind you. Okay.
It's coming from the window.
It's coming from the side. Okay. Let's say you turn towards that light. I know that right now there is a mirror. Okay. That's what is reflecting. But in this, it would be great if you turn towards the light. Okay. Again, a live example. Again, with Shivani. Yes. With Shivani, if you see, there is light from her left, if I'm not wrong. Is it from your left? Yes, I think so. Okay. Yeah, you see this? Half of your face is very well lit, while the other half is not. So how can you rearrange yourself?
Okay, so I'm just a little awkwardly angled here. So my table is actually not facing the light.
Got it.
So, but if I had to add, I would like possibly like move the entire.
Yes. You get it. So this is exactly what I wanted all of us to really think about. It's a very simple thing. We see these lights every day in our houses, but how do we use them is something that we have to think about. Yeah. It's really sad that I'm myself darkly lit. I'm in a very unlit position right now, but ideally I should have been here. Okay. If I should be turning this way and my device should be kept there. I'm not moving my device because I have arrange it in a certain way with all my wires and everything hanging around. So I'm not going to turn. Yeah. So I think this is something that we should consider even during our classes. And let's say we go on talks and things like that. This is something that we have to consider. Yeah. Next. With that, I will move on to our next section, which is performing. Digital spaces to perform and host events. These are some of the platforms. We know, I think most of us know about these. Instagram, Facebook, YouTube, Vimeo. These are some popular ones. Chalet has also created its own platform, like an OTT platform for the performing arts. So that which is why I put that here. On my left, you can see something called Play2Me. This is a very, very new platform that has come about during the lockdown time. Many of my singer friends are singing on this. Okay, this is a platform where you can sing, present a concert from your home, and people have to buy the subscription, buy tickets to watch you perform. So these are all the options. And the one below is Patreon. Patreon is another, is yet another app where you can put out your content, create content, especially for this. And what this does is, through Patreon, you can ask people to subscribe to your channel and they become your patrons and you can monetize it as well. Of course, we'll talk about monetization at the end of this presentation. So these are all some of the options. With Facebook, we can, of course, post. The stories have come in recently, that is there. We can go live. We can also premiere. We will talk about premiering and going live in detail. Instagram, similarly, stories and IGTV. I'm only talking about videos, not really about photos. And then YouTube, we can premiere and post. Vimeo, premiere and post. Playtoom, like I told you, it's a digital concert that we can create. Chalet is running as both a platform where you can run your concerts, as well as they have a space, a digital auditorium. We will speak about that as well. Patreon, we can post. Jixi is another platform. This has been started very recently. I think over the past 1 year or so, I've attended a couple of their sessions. They seem like an interesting, that the platform seems very interesting. Some of you can check it out. Going live. Okay, so this is what most of the dancers and musicians have done in the last 3 months. Much, much more than what we used to do earlier. Yeah. So we all know how to go live. I'm not going to really, talk about, go here, click on this button, go live. No, I'm not going to do that. Instead, we will talk about this. Checklist. Phone to be kept in landscape mode. This is very important. Okay, so here. Yeah. When I say landscape, I'm talking about this. Keeping the phone. I know most of us go live on Facebook or Instagram from our phones, right? We really don't use our laptops. It's for obvious reasons. So, and also the camera on phone is much, much better these days than a laptop. Yeah. So when we go live on Facebook, please use the camera, the phone this way. This is the landscape mode. Okay. But this comes with an other attached point, which is before you start your live, make sure the auto rotate is on. The reason being, when the auto rotate is on, which means you turn and all the images also turn, right? That's your auto rotate. So when the auto rotate is on and then you start the live post, the comments that appear also appear this way. I've been seeing this in many performances, live performances that are happening. I've been noticing this. If you don't keep your auto rotate on and then turn the phone landscape mode and start the performance, the comments will appear this way. Okay, thank God. So the electricity board has shown some mercy on me. Okay, so please make sure that is done. Okay, this is a very, very simple thing, but makes a big difference. Makes a huge difference. Okay, we don't want to really look at the comments this way, right? Like it's very odd. Okay, it's very odd. So please make sure that happens. So one, keep your phone on landscape mode. Before you start the live, turn your auto rotate to on. And how will you know that it is on? As soon as you go into Facebook and turn, everything should turn. Okay, once that is done, then go live. Then press the live button and go. Again, like I told you, please use a tripod when you want to go live on Facebook through your or Facebook or Instagram through your mobile phone. Okay, please use a tripod. Very important. Now, we'll continue. There are a few more points that we have to consider. Use back camera. Again, this is something that I've been noticing. So many of us are using front camera. The difference being, back camera has a better output than front camera. So please use the back camera. And Why the camera lens? You know, you might be wondering why I have written this point. It's something that I have learned. I did this mistake. So about 2 months ago, I've been running live sessions for several artists and educators over the last 2 months. We were running one of these sessions. Everything was set. We had a camera, the mic was set, lighting. We concentrated on everything. We started the live session. And about, as soon as we started, somehow felt something was off. Something was missing. Something was not fine. And then we never could figure. Then we thought it was an internet connection. Then we thought it's something else. So many other thoughts came into mind. Finally, at the end of the session, when we were about to finish, 5 minutes to the end of the session, I realized that I had not wiped the lens of the camera, of the phone. See, as photographers, I'm sure Sudhi will say yes to this. As photographers, we always wipe the lens, cover it, keep it inside. That has become a habit. With phones, there is not a habit with any of us, right? How many of us really take out our phone, wipe the lens, and then go live? We really have to make that a habit. It's a small thing, but makes a big difference. Yeah. Again, out of my experience, I really felt so silly after doing that session where I didn't wipe my lens. Then, going further, plan opening slide and ambience music. This is something we are, as dancers, musicians, as artists, we always want to concentrate on our aesthetics, right? For example, let's say a physical performance in A.D. Rangamandira or Ravindra Kalakshetra or Chodaya. When audiences are entering the hall, do we leave the hall just empty without any music? No. 95%, there is some ambience music that is played. And also on the screen, we project the logo, or maybe we create a profile, we create a light where the brand of our organizations is projected. There is something that is happening, isn't it? I think we should plan that even in our live performances on Facebook and Instagram. And it is very simple to do. Very, very simple. I was talking to you about Bluetooth speakers, right? Just play some music, let it be, start your live and let it run. The audiences who join, as they come in, they will listen to your ambient music. And then of course your program can continue. I think these things that we really have to keep in mind for the aesthetics of it. Switching off comments. Again, this is something I've seen that many of us forget to do, especially on Instagram as the performance begins, there is an option. There are three dots in the comment section. Click on it. It says hide comments. You can do that. And then people who are commenting. This will not disturb others who want to watch the performance without this intrusion, without this comment intrusion. So please switch off the comments after your initial introduction, etc., when the actual performance is happening. Okay, so it'll be great if the comments are switched off. Next, being cognizant about copyrights. All of us artists have been performing left, right, center. Okay, which is great. I'm not against it. But I think it's high time we took into consideration the copyright issues. For example, with dancers, the music that we are using, do we have complete copyrights over it? And is it okay to play that particular track and perform on it for a live session? I am again emphasizing for Facebook, Instagram, YouTube live session, because it is going to stay for posterity unless we delete it. Okay, which means anybody has access to that music, and all of that is very easily downloadable. So please do keep this in mind. Okay, it's very important as artists to be cognizant of our copyrights of the tracks that we are using. Next. This is very, very important. Full tech rehearsal at least a day in advance. We always go to our performing area much before the performance itself, right? We make sure that the sound is right. There's a music check that has happened. Lights are fine. We set the lights. Okay, we also do a spacing, a stage run. It is very important to do that for our live performances, even if it's from our homes or from our dance classes. Very important, for the sole reason being, are we using the camera right? Are we making sure the settings that we have spoken about in this presentation and many more, have they all been taken into consideration? Have we done that? So it is important that we do a full tech rehearsal. Also, I have written this year, preferably at the same time. Again, the reason being, especially when it comes to live performances, the bandwidth of our Wi-Fi modems really varies at different points in the day. So for example, I have observed this. On Saturday evenings, the traffic is much, much higher, especially, you know, when it comes to performances. So what do you do then? So how are you able to, you know, navigate that? Also, when we rehearse it at the same time the previous day, we know exactly what is happening. One is the Wi-Fi. Of course, that's not really in our control. To some extent, we can't control it at all. A few other things that we can control. Lighting. Natural lights. Let's say we are rehearsing for a, let's say we have an event that is happening at 2 in the afternoon. It will really not be ideal for me to rehearse the previous day at 7 in the night. The reason being, at 2, the light is completely different. Completely different. Whereas at 7, I'm completely dependent on my bulbs, my house lights or my pro lights. So we really have to consider this. Again, this applies, I'm just not talking about dancers here, even for musicians. You know, as musicians, I'm sure all of you want to look in a certain way on the camera, right? Because we are just not, the moment we say Facebook Live, the video aspect comes into picture, whether we like it or not. Yeah, so I think it's important that we consider that and rehearse exactly at the same time, around the same time, the previous day, 24 hours. The reason I'm putting 24 hours is only for one thing. If there's something that you have to do, you have enough time. If you have to go buy something, if there's something that you have to tweak, technically, I'm not talking about the performance. I'm not talking about the artistry here. I'm talking only about the tech aspects. We still can do. Okay, so it's really important that we do a full tech rehearsal, especially for live events. Because when we announce a live event and people are waiting for us and it doesn't happen, it is very sad. Okay, it's really sad. It has been happening for so many of the artists. I feel bad at that time. Yes, at the end of it all, certain things can't be controlled, but at least we should be able to control things that we can. So it's important that we do a full tech run. Now I'll speak about the Creator Studio. This is an option given in Facebook. I know that many of us as performers have taken to live very easily. Okay, we are used to live performances. And when I say live, I'm talking about an auditorium live. We are all used to live auditorium performances. We have literally translated that into a Facebook or an Instagram live. But there are other options, other better options when we are talking about Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube. So here it is. This is an option given to all the pages. So this can't be done from an individual's account. We need to have a page, okay, on Facebook. And any page will have this. There is no, it's not like you need this many friends or this many viewers, nothing. Anybody will have the same set of tools. Here you see something called the publishing tool. Yeah, you click on that. You click on, can you see this? Publishing tools. You click on this and this will open up. And here you will find something called the Creator Studio. It says tools below and it says Creator Studio. If you get into Creator Studio, you will find this option open. Like you see this, this is something that we can all explore. Okay, I have highlighted one aspect here. The highlighted aspect here, I'm talking about uploading a video and going live. Going live, we have already spoken. Okay, no problem about that. We'll talk about uploading video. Here, there are options. A single video, multiple videos, and post videos across all pages. So let's say you have you're running 2-3 pages. And you can post the same video across all the pages at the same time. That is possible. Okay, so we need to really explore this Creator Studio. And on the other side, on the left, if you see, you know, we have these options, the insights. This gives us statistical data about which are the videos that are performing better, what is our audience demographic. With these, we will be able to create content in a much, much better way, in an informed way. Yeah, and they also are talking about monetization. So we can explore monetization through Facebook rights as well. Then, creator tools, etc. Now, we'll again concentrate on this. Single video, multiple video, and posting video across platforms. Once we do this, let's say you want to put out a video and this option opens up and I have put out this video of mine. This done as a screenshot. So I drag and drop a video and it uploads. You'll find this 100% upload. Now, there are two aspects here. One is, yeah, you create a post, you write, this all of us know, right? We tag a few people, then we tag, hashtags are all put in place and there's a little description that is written. Now on the right here, you will find publishing options. If you click on that, this will open up. In publishing options, there is these are the tools. One, you can post it as a video. Like how we post a photo, you can post a video directly. On the other hand, we can premiere, which means premiering is like a live video. It's like going live on Facebook. people will not be able to go to the end of the video and see it. They'll have to see the video as and when it comes. It's a proper premiere. Okay. And when this is happening, you'll also get that little red tag on the video which says premiere. Okay. So we can premiere it. And again, we don't have to do it immediately. It says one is published now. If you want to publish now, you can do that as well. This also allows you to schedule. This is very important in my opinion, because once you know that you want to schedule a particular video or a work that you have created on a particular date, you can create a buzz about it, promote the event. Okay. Now you can schedule this date, time is given. Once you do this, you don't have to sit in front of Facebook to upload it, because the file is already uploaded. Facebook does the job for you, which is great. Okay, we can sit back and enjoy. We can watch our own work as a premiere, comment and have fun with our friends, literally. Okay, we don't really have to bother much, a big headache taken off. So this is something that we really have to seriously consider, all of us, as artists in today's times where digital media looks like almost the only way to put our content out. Yeah. Again, going further, what are the other benefits? You can create well-produced content, really well thought about, well curated, well edited, well produced content can be created because these options are there. We will talk about creating produced content in detail in my next session. Okay. Today we know that these options are there. Now, similarly, the same creator studio, which I was speaking to you about for the Facebook, has this. So if you see the highlighted portion here, this is for Facebook. If you click on the other button here, it goes to Instagram. Okay. And this opens up. Right now, what they have done on Instagram is we really can't post videos like a premiere and all of this yet. The creator studio for Instagram right now gives you access to insights, statistical data for your Instagram account. Okay. You really can go through the statistics and, you can gauge the pulse of your audience through this. I am sure eventually they will put in the other options for this as well, which is great, because on one creator studio you are able to access two different accounts altogether. One is Facebook, the other being Instagram. YouTube, again, similar options on you. YouTube again is a very, very robust platform. It's the audiences, if you're able to build on YouTube, is great. And you can also monetize your YouTube videos really well. Okay. So today we'll talk about just simple things about uploading. Even here, we can upload our videos on YouTube. Again, these are the things that come up, and then we can schedule it. Even here, we can schedule it. Set as a premiere. That is an option here as well. Very similar to Facebook premiere. So we can premiere it here and create a buzz about that particular premiere. Now, with this, we will move on to the third topic, which is conversations, interviews, and conferences. Some of you already spoke about, utilizing this time to interact with other artists. I think Sukanya ma'am spoke about how she's looking at options to interact with other artists. This is what we are going to talk about here. StreamYard and Zoom, these are two platforms that I have explored and I am comfortable with, and we will be speaking about it today. Through these platforms, through Zoom, you can have an interview, have a conference, conversations. Also, if you see in the last 2.5 months, all artists, everyone that I have known, we've all gotten into this habit of speaking to other artists online, which is a great thing, great way to share knowledge, isn't it? And also, this can be done effectively through these things. So on StreamYard, by the way, is a completely free software to begin with. You can go live through StreamYard on Facebook on a free account, whereas you cannot do that with Zoom. Okay, you cannot really go live on Zoom just with a basic plan. You need to buy a pro plan. Yeah. So I'm going to concentrate on StreamYard because it's a free software, and you can go live on Facebook, YouTube, and Twitch. If somebody is on Twitch, you can use that too. StreamYard. This is how the first, after you sign up, after you create your account in StreamYard, this is how the first window appears. Here you can add people. So here you see an invite here. When you get this, when you click on this, a link appears. That link can be shared with the people that you want to have on the interview. let's say I am interviewing Sumana today and I want to go live on Facebook. I will send this invite to Sumana. She'll also come on. So we'll both be here. So my image will come in this small tab here and Sumana's will come here. And then when I just drag and drop it here, it'll go on to the bigger thing. Also, why I say StreamYard is better is because you can create branding. So for example, you can write these things. Performing Arts Conference can be written. And the name of the person who's speaking there appears and can be written with some branding. Okay. And you can also do different views. For example, you can have two, if you want both of them to appear on Facebook next to each other, that is possible. Let's say you have about five people in the conference. StreamYard supports six at the moment. So let's say there are five people in the conference and you want to highlight one person in a bigger way and have other people in small boxes, that is possible. So there are various layouts that StreamYard has already given and we can use it. Also, a fantastic option is you can scroll something. For example, the conference is happening, the interview is happening, and you want to send a scroll which says, visit my website, www.music.org, for example. That can scroll, that can come continuously. So this kind of branding can happen. By doing all these things, the output is so much more professional. It is so much more good to look at. The audience will definitely want to look at these things. For example, this is how you do it. There is a banner here on the right side. If you click on the banners, you can click any number of banners and make it happen. Simple to use. As you click on them, the options are options appear and you can experiment and explore. Brand and private chat, all those things are there. Okay, so this is with StreamYard. On Zoom, this is how you do it. Okay, this is again a screenshot. You will find this as you have to start the meeting first. Once the meeting is started, and if you have a pro account, you have to click on more, and here you will see live on Facebook, live on YouTube. You can click on that. If it's a slide share, on the other hand, if you want to just send a meeting itself, again, live on Facebook, live on YouTube. That's also possible. Okay. So before we go to the next part, I just want to talk about a couple of aspects that we have spoken with respect to conferences and interviews that are sent. I spoke to you all about having ambience music, right? Before a show. Similarly, even in a conference, it is always good that you start the slide share, create the first slide, keep it ready on the presentation. Let's say that slide can talk about, for example, if it is today's meeting, if you have to take it online, the first slide, this says embracing the digital space, that can appear there. I'll play some music from my Bluetooth speaker and I go live after that, which means as soon as I go live, you won't find a person struggling to toggle between different windows. No, it's not very appealing. On the other hand, you have this, people come into this live stream, they're looking at a professional slide with some ambient music. Then of course you get out of the slide share and start speaking, start interviewing your other attendees, just to give it a little more professional aesthetic outlook. The thing is, these options are there. As artists, we just have to use it. I'm really not here to talk about this is there, use this. No, that I think if you Google, you'll all very easily understand how to use Zoom, StreamYard. All this is available on Google, on the internet platforms. My intention here today is only about utilizing these things for arts. How can we make the experience better? How can we make the experience better for our audiences? So that's exactly what. And again, these are things I have been able to do in the last 2 months. I've run a couple of digital conferences and live talk shows. And also I've been running other live education shows. Apart from streaming premiere events, well-produced content, which is being premiered. So which is why, based on this knowledge, I'm trying to put in as many points as possible that might be helpful for all of you. Yeah, we'll continue. We'll talk about digital auditoria next. In today's discussion, we will only be speaking about what a digital auditorium is, what it does, and at the same time, if we have to choose a digital auditorium, what are the points to consider? Yeah, like I told you, Chalet has a digital auditorium, which means they have a space. When I'm talking about a digital auditorium, here there is a space to perform, to produce your content, but there is no space for audiences to come and sit and watch then and there. It is not a Chaudhary Memorial. It is not a music academy, for example. Okay, this is a space without the audiences, but a well-equipped space, well-equipped for the content to be put out digitally. That is a digital auditorium. Shale is a classic example. Now, another over the last few months, I've also come across few other professional studios. For example, Natya Institute, there are other studios. All of us, all the dance schools have their own studios today, right? That dance studio can very easily be converted into a digital auditorium. We will speak about how to make it a digital auditorium in the next session, not today. And other home, I'm just not talking about these studios. I'm even talking about our homes. We can really make a concert happen from our homes. Okay. So checklist, space availability for performance. How do you choose a digital auditorium? If, you know, it really depends on what kind of art form you want to present. Is it a solo? Is it a group ensemble work? If it is musicians, how many musicians? And that will really determine the availability, you know, the space, because we need that much space to move around or present it. And coming to pro lights and pro lawn, when we talk about a digital auditorium, see, we have definitely moved a step ahead. It is really not our classroom. It is not our homes anymore. The outlook is a little more professional, right? We need professional outlook. So we have to choose a space which has pro lights, pro sound, especially for musicians and dancers. Sound is so important. Okay, we really can't mess with that. So that is important. Then streaming facilities. Because we are talking about, you know, putting our content out in the digital space, the streaming facilities have to be top notch. We really have to have high bandwidth for the Wi-Fi, not just a modem. I'm not talking about a good internet connectivity. I'm talking about streaming facilities, which means there should be enough software and hardware, you know, which we will speak about in detail in the next session. Okay, like a very good, fast gaming laptop. Okay, the reason I'm talking about a gaming laptop is generally the RAM is higher, the processing speeds are good, graphic cards are good. So we need to have a console of laptops, 2-3 laptops. Then, with softwares like, you know, OBS and other third-party streamers, which are very good, which can be used for this. And if you are using a multicam setup, we need a box, a converter that will mix all of this and send one data to the server. Similarly, if you are using, you know, for sound, we'll need that mixer, which is able to, you know, condense all the audio input and give it without the rate dropping for the internet. As it is, any content, you might even create content in 4K and, you know, top HD, but Facebook and Instagram already reduces it to 720p, max to max 1080p, which means whether we like it or not, the content resolution is already reduced. So we should not create bad content. When I say bad content, I'm talking about resolution. Okay, we should not be creating content with low resolution, because it's going to get further reduced. So things like that. So we need same facilities and informed tech crew. We really need, you know, a crew which is really knowledgeable about all these things, which is up to date, especially in today's times. You know, we really can't work with people who have stopped updating themselves, because digital world is evolving every day. Every day, even as we are speaking, there are so many things that might have changed, that might have evolved. We really have to be, you know, on the job. And even if we are not, at least we should hire a crew that is, okay, that knows the work. And definitely insist on tech rehearsals. Again, this is something we have learned from STEM, from Natya. You know, Maya Didi, Madhu Natraj, all our gurus, they've always insisted on having tech rehearsals, complete tech rehearsals. And it is so important, especially when we are depending so much on technology itself. Technology plays such a crucial aspect, and rehearsals definitely matter a lot. Here is an example of home studio. This is my home studio. You can see here I have set up, you know, my tripod for phone, and I have a couple of professional lights. These things can be converted. Okay, homes can be converted. How to convert them? What are all the tools required? We will speak about it in detail in my next session. Now we'll come to our last aspect for this presentation. Monetization. You know, all of us have put out enough and more free content, and all of us as artists are really wondering how we can monetize. With this explosion in the digital space, the opportunity is endless. We can reach a very, very wide audience. We really don't have to concentrate on getting students from our community, our geographical location. Gone are the days. We can reach out to the entire world. It is possible. But the only thing is we have to create the modules that are suitable for online delivery. Creating workshops and courses designed specifically for the digital medium. This is where we really have to think about what are the kinds of audio visual aids that I can develop? What are the kinds of courses that will, make somebody want to join this? It can be our own art form. It can be the same Kathak, same Bharatanatyam, same music, same instruments. But how can we repackage it? Okay, how can we reinvent the delivery of it? That is something that as art, we are all creative people. I'm sure we can come up with creative concepts. So we really have to look into that. Then once that is done, like I told you, we can reach out to the entire world. And obviously we can monetize the workshops, the classes, whatnot. Coming to the performances. Performing on platforms like Book My Show, Shale, Playtoon, YouTube. So here, all these are wide and varied. So what Book My Show has done is, again, something that I got to know just a few days ago. We all know Book My Show is this ticketing platform, right? With this online live performances becoming such a rage, they have offered their services into this field. We can create an event, collaborate with them, ticket the event. We can, through them, the event is ticketed and the shows can happen. That is a possibility. I think all of us as artists should explore that. Shale is already doing it. Shale, not just now, has been doing it from almost 2 or 3 years now. They've had this paid live stream that they've been doing, and now it is all the more helpful. So Shale is a great platform too. Playtoom, this is something I told you in the beginning of the presentation. This has started just about a month ago. After the lockdown, somebody started this. Playtoom.me. I don't even know how it is pronounced. Playtoom or Playtoom.me. But whatever, please check this out. This is very helpful for musicians especially. Or at least at the moment. Because all my musicians' friends are performing on this. Here again, they can create their performances from their homes. It is put on Playtoom. And people buy subscription, buy the tickets, and they can watch it. It's a great platform. With YouTube, it is a different ballgame. You need to become a partner account with YouTube for you to be able to monetize the content that is being put out. For you to become a partner account, you need to have a minimum of 1,000 subscribers to your channel and X number of views. Some data have been given. We can always check that out. Over the last 12 months, once that is done, ads can appear on your content with every click, with every view. The entire content can be monetized. But YouTube has an extremely stringent policy about copyrights content. For example, I cannot take a film music for which another label like T-Series or Z has copyrights over. I create something based on that. I put out the content. I will not be able to monetize it. Even that amount will be sent directed towards the company which has copyrights. So it is high time as artists, we really start thinking about copyrights. If we have to monetize our work, we need to create original work and create work for which we have complete copyrights over. So YouTube is very, very good. The reach is great. It is an established platform, very well reputed. So we as artists, we should really be looking at that, building our base on that. Then on other models like Facebook, Patreon, Jixi, we have a few options like the donate button. Many art organizations are not-for-profit organizations. This comes into play there. We can use the donate button. We can ask people to click on it, make a donation for the sustenance of the artist, for the life of the institution itself. That is possible because as artists, as institutions, we are going to constantly create work, put it out there. We might as well look at possibilities of getting money through these donate buttons and things like that. With Patreon and Jixi, it is a subscription model. We create work, we have patrons. So again, there are slabs. Patreon that way is very good. They have created different slabs. And you can say monthly, for example, as a patron, I subscribe to an institution's or a person's work. So it means that every month I'll pay X amount to that person, which goes to the person directly. Of course, after this commission that is taken by Patreon. And they get to see that amount of content. And apart from this, we also have several crowdfunding platforms through which we can raise money for causes and for so many other things. Raise money for tours, of course, no more tours, at least for the next 1.5 years. But yeah, we can raise money through crowdfunding for our projects. That these are some of the options. But beyond all these things, if you see, I have created a circle here. One supports the other, one leads to the other. In my opinion, the last point here, which is, this is very important because creating curated content for the camera with professional output. Again and again and again, we are constantly talking about putting work out there on digital space, which means how much ever we may create as artists, it is all shown through the camera and it is all done on the editing table. So we really need to think through this. How can we create curated content for the camera with professional output? If that is good, if the work is good, obviously the work can reach a wider audience. If it reaches a wider audience, more money comes into the organization, into the artist kitty. With more money coming in, better work can be created. You know, it is a complete cycle. It's an ecosystem. One feeds the other. So all of us really need to think about putting out professional work. Work of professional quality in terms of technicalities. And not all of us are adept with everything. We might be great artists. But if you want to, if you feel like you need to work with a good camera person, a good editor, a good social media person, please do that. Okay, we can't do everything all by ourselves. If we want our work to be professional and reach wider people, wider audience base, I think we really have to look at that. So with this, I complete my presentation. And yes, digital space has been embraced in brackets to some extent. We'll try to do this a little more in our next session, 15 days from now. Thank you so much. If there
Thanks
are
so any much, questions, Keithi.
Observations, yeah. we can go over right now.
Yeah, if there are comments, observations, feedback, questions, anything, please shoot. You can unmute
I have a question, yeah. Keithi. So you spoke about going live through Zoom on Facebook and YouTube, right? Is it possible to do the same when you're even through your phone? Is that option there? For some reason, say there is a talk we do and we have no laptop. So is there an option? Because I can't find it in the phone. That option of going live on through Zoom on in the phone.
Interesting question. I have not explored it myself. Because I understand why you're asking this. You know, in places where we might not be able to carry our laptops, phone is the only option. I have not explored this. But if you are considering that, I know for a fact StreamYard can help you with it. Because StreamYard is not an application-based software. It is a web browser-based software.
Okay. It comes as an app or something or on the phone?
So StreamYard is not an app. For example, Zoom is an app, isn't it? We all use the Zoom app. Whereas with StreamYard, it is not an app. It is you'll have to open your Google Chrome or Safari.
As a browser,
yes. So I'm sure, you know, of course, I'll definitely look at it today. And in my opinion, StreamYard, we should be able to do it from the web browser because from the phone because it's a browser-based application.
Okay, thank you.
I have a question regarding StreamYard. Can it also be used for performances or only for conferences?
No, absolutely. We can use it for performances. It is possible.
Classes as well, right? I can conduct classes on StreamYard.
So classes, I'm not sure because it allows only 6 people to come on board together. So also what has happened is StreamYard has been developed specifically for interviews and conferences that can be streamed on other platforms. That is the reason that they've developed StreamYard. But if we have to, use it for classrooms, we can use it, but we will have only 6 people in the classroom. That's the only problem. Okay. But performances, yes, it is possible.
Okay, thank you. Just one more question. I know you talked about Facebook and Instagram together on Creator Studio, but is it possible that I share the same content on both? Like if I post my content on like video on Facebook, how do I post it on Insta? And if I post it on Insta, how do I get it on Facebook? It's very confusing.
It is. It is. Right now, they have not given an option where we can simultaneously put out content as it is on the app. That can be done. It's a very complex procedure. It needs something called RTMPS link. Okay. And we will speak about those things in my next session. Okay. That's an advanced session that we are talking about. Through an RTMPS link, we can stream simultaneously on two platforms. That is possible. On the other hand, the same possibility is there on StreamYard. We can simultaneously stream on two platforms, which is Facebook and YouTube. That is possible from StreamYard. But Facebook and Instagram, we don't have an option yet. At least to my knowledge, we don't have an option. I don't know if somebody knows about it, please enlighten me too.
Please do take this up in your next workshop. It will be really helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Kirti, for this very enriching session. Now, regarding classes, when you do it on Google Meet, the screen of the host comes in a stamp size.
Correct.
So that's especially when you take classes, you need to see your frame. Which one would you suggest?
I would definitely suggest Teams.
Okay, because Zoom is also better. At least you have an option to see the full frame. But Google Meet, this is
I complete. Vinijay, I completely agree. I have myself not been very comfortable with Google Meet. Initially, this whole Zoom, there was this security concerns and all that about Zoom started. I started exploring other platforms. Google Meet was one of them. I did explore, but somehow I felt it was not great as an experience. Also, one is the thing very rightly how you pointed out, the host is, window is very small, one thing. Second is, I'm sure Sai Tejas here will agree, there is a lag. We tried Sai Tejas and I tried this. There is a big lag as you proceed in class. Okay, so you go on saying it. What the students hear is almost after some 5-10 seconds, which is not very helpful. On the other hand, they will say something, we hear it after some 15-20 seconds. So this happened on Google Meet, although the internet connection was very good. But those things are handled really well on Zoom. I personally like Zoom a lot. I really like the experience of Zoom. And also they have solved many issues over the last 1 month.
You would recommend Zoom to Teams?
Yes, for sure. Yeah. I would recommend Zoom, but I know first what has happened is again another experience. When recently we started a course and a couple of students outside of India who enrolled were not very comfortable using Zoom. Okay, and we had to explore other options. WebEx was something that we tried that worked well for us. But in my opinion, Teams is really good.
Okay.
Teams, we should definitely, if not Zoom, let's go for Teams.
Yeah, Zoom is, as you said, this lag, the problem doesn't exist.
Yes.
But as far as the payment, it's an annual subscription, right? They don't have monthly subscriptions.
Coming to the pro account of Zoom, the way I was able to do it was, of course, they ask you for the credit card details. And there are two, you can choose between the monthly and the annual.
But I think they have only the annual. And see, we are people who are dying to have, this is the last option we'll go for, especially for finance.
I understand this. In fact, what I have done, I have taken a monthly subscription, meaning the billing is monthly. Okay, so that's what the thing is. You have just have to choose that. Of course, they will, sort of entice you by saying, if you take the annual, there's some discount, etc. But very rightly pointed out, I really wouldn't want to put that kind of money right now upfront for an annual subscription. And also, what if things open up? Positive, I'm just being, hyper positive here. What if things open up and we can go back to our studio and conduct classes? No, I'll be more than happy to do that. Yeah. But yeah, there is a monthly option. Although it is annual, the billing is
monthly. But Teams, we don't have these problems at all. The lag issue is down there.
The lag issue solved to a great extent.
Even for the students to log in and explore, it's better. You would recommend
it. The thing is, it's like, you know, Zoom is just a click of a button, you get everything, no doubt. Yeah. But with Teams, we just have to explore it. Like, we don't get it one click. Okay, we just have to go maybe two steps or three steps. But once we get used to it, in my opinion, Teams is very, very good.
Thank you so much.
I had a question. Hello. Yeah, hi. So I did an FB Live performance just a few days ago. And the video, all my viewers told me that the video was excellent, but the audio was very spotty. Now, as a musician, as a singer, I would prefer the opposite.
Correct.
So is there a way to control that? And if not on FB, is there another platform which allows me to control this?
Okay. We'll talk about FB first. Okay. Can we control it? Yes, we can control it. Okay. So how? One is Srijan, I'm not sure. Did you use a mic and a mixer, everything?
No, I just did it on my phone. I actually have a mixer and an audio interface and everything, but I found that I got better results on my phone with just the phone microphone.
Okay.
So I went with that.
So, Srijan, I very, very strongly would recommend that we use the mixer. Okay. And how? Basically, I'm sure, as mentioned with the mixer things, you know what an audio interface does, right? So you connect the audio interface to the laptop, and on the other side, it's connected to the mic. If you do it this way, the audio output is much, much better. It will not be choppy. The main reason being, the phone's mic is not really meant for a performance. It is not. That is the only thing. Yeah, we really need to use a mixer and audio interface. So that's the only way. Of course, we will speak in detail about this in my next session.
All right. Okay. Thank you.
We have one question here from Anisha. All of us can see this here. Anisha is asking us if you could speak about your experience with Jitsi and Blue Room.
Blue Room. Okay. Blue Room, I'm not aware at all. I've not explored it.
Whereas, I think she meant blue jeans.
I don't know if she meant blue jeans.
Blue jeans. Because earlier she wrote blue jeans. Yeah.
Okay.
Blue jeans, I have very, very basic knowledge. When I got to know that this platform existed, I tried it on. It is robust. The reviews are great. Okay. Reviews are just great on about blue jeans, but it does come with a subscription. Again, it is some $20 something. They have their own subscription model. With whatever I have read up about BlueJeans, I just took downloaded BlueJeans, did one meeting just to try out how it works out. Okay, it was good. The experience was fair enough, but I've really not explored it. But I've read quite a few reviews about BlueJeans. The reviews are just fantastic. And BlueJeans is one of the most widely used platforms in Europe and US, is what I've been told. Okay, so yes, this is what I know about BlueJeans. Coming to Jitsi. Jitsi is it is again a platform where we put out content. Okay, it's very similar to Patreon in a way. We put out content and we can also, categorize them as, tier one, tier two, like for example, gold, copper, that kind of categories are there. So let's say I create I sing a cover song, which is about 5 minutes in length, if that falls under one category, I create an original work and I put it out in another category. So that can be done, and your audiences can choose to pay for a category and become a patron of that particular category. So that is possible. And for going further, this is the basic model from whatever I have understood. Going further, we can also create and promote our events otherwise. Let's say I'm doing a live on Facebook. I can take that link, put it on Jitsi. That is possible. And through Jitsi, I can ask people to pay for it and subscribe to it and things like that. That is also possible. Of course, I've really not explored it much. I got to attend two sessions by the founders of Jitsi. One of my friend, who's also a singer, Gurupriya Athreya. So she was coordinating with them, and she told me about it. I attended the session. The app was quite interesting. What they've really gone out to do, because I'm sure it's going to evolve, app will evolve. What they've gone out to do is help artists reach out to their audiences and monetize it. This is what they're trying.
I think we can take a couple of questions before we end this session.
Yes. Sumana, I have a question. Sorry to interrupt.
Who is this now?
Rashmi.
Yes, it's hi Rashmi. Yes, go on, go on.
Yeah, Kirti, sorry. You mentioned about playing the karaoke track while we are singing for the live show or while we are recording a video.
Yes.
Hello? Yeah. Yes. So I want more clarity on that. You spoke about Bluetooth speaker, external mic. Can you throw some more light? And now you told to Srijan about mixer and audio interface. I'm really not tech savvy to that extent. But yes, I have been doing live shows wherein I come across issues like karaoke is heard, my voice is not heard. My voice is overpowering the karaoke track, and then the output is really bad sometimes. So okay. I do it on my phone, iPhone. So okay. Now how to go about it?
Okay, simple. So I'll tell you, this is a classic problem that all of us are facing. You know? Not just singers as dancers, all of us, you know, with anything to performing arts, which has music in it, we are facing this issue.
Yeah.
The good solution for this would definitely be to invest on an audio interface, a mic, which can be connected to the laptop. Yeah. What it does is basically what we are trying to do is example, on one side you are singing, on the other side you are playing karaoke music, right? These are two different audio outputs. This has to go through one input, which is your phone's mic. Phone's mic into the stream. The phone mic cannot capture both of it in the way that we want it to be captured, because we have to equalize it. We have to, you know, really work on the levels, isn't it? Sometimes we want our voice to be higher, the reverb. You know, we know as much as we know.
A lot of it goes into it.
Yeah. So that needs to be controlled. That can be controlled only with a device which will connect the two inputs first. That input is an audio interface.
Mm-hmm.
And once it is connected, once that is equalized, this sends the equalized sound to the laptop from which we are going live.
Okay. So, if I'm going live on my phone and I'm playing the karaoke track on my tablet, so I need to have an audio interface and connect it to both phone as well as tablet. Okay.
No, it is not. So now it is a little more complicated. It's just not as simple as that. Okay. Especially when we work with the audio interface and things like that, I always suggest that we go live from the laptop and not from the phone. Again, remember the first slide that I showed you? Of the three devices, laptop, tablet, and phone, my first preference always is laptop. It is a stable device. Much more can be achieved. Second, as a peripheral device, as a device that is going to support you, tablet, yes. Phone, that is my last resort. That's my last resort. On the other hand, next session, we will talk about how a phone can be used as an important device to connect to the laptop.
Mm-hmm.
Not as a device from where I'm going to go live. I'm still going to go live on my laptop. But phone can be used as a very important device which can be connected to the laptop, and it will aid me in my live sessions.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
All so, right. We'll take one. Sorry, Rashmi.
We'll come to that next session.
We'll have one last question. Saithi just wants to ask one question and we'll end the session with that. Yes. Yeah.
Check. Yeah. So, Kirti, you were talking about the premiering of videos. So, I just wanted to know whether the video which you've premiered, will stay on the platform. For example, if I'm premiering the video on Facebook, will it be there or will it just disappear after premiering? How does it work?
It will be there. It will be there till you delete it, which is a great option, right? Because some of us might not be able to watch the premiere itself. I'll come back and watch it later. So that way the video will stay.
Okay, so I just wanted to know the actual difference between premiere and scheduling. So can you please?
For all practical purposes, it is the same. Okay, the only difference is let's say I say Premiere. You remember, if you go back to the slide, I say Premiere, I get two options. Premiere publish now, scheduled. If I say publish now, it will premiere immediately. As soon as you click the button, it will premiere. Okay. On the other hand, if you say scheduled, it will schedule, it will premiere only at the time that you have scheduled it for.
Okay. Got it. Thank you.
And also going back to Rashmi Vikas's question, if you actually look at Sai Tejas's window right now, okay, he has a mic, he has a complete setup. Yeah. We can actually ask him to present a full performance right now, where he can use multiple sources of audio along with his voice, and the show will be very good to listen to in terms of technicalities. Of course, yeah. He's a great artist, that's another thing. So also in terms of technicalities, it'll be really good, because that setup has already been is done there. It's already in place there.
True. So if I have an external mic and I'm going live on my laptop and playing the karaoke track on any other device, so will that be good?
Okay, I'll give you a simple solution at the moment without getting into the technicalities of it. Mm-hmm. Do you see this?
Yeah.
This is my left.
Yes.
One second, I'll show you one more. So this particular mic, the brand is called Boya, B-O-Y-A. Okay.
Okay.
It's available on Amazon and in all places. The reviews are good, and I'm having a good experience. So
okay.
This particular Boya, there are two mics.
Okay.
Okay. This, in my opinion, will solve your problem immediately.
Okay.
The reason being, this does not need mixer. This needs nothing. Okay. What you can do is, on one side, like you said, you will play your karaoke from the iPad and connect it to your Bluetooth speaker. Okay. Keep one mic near the Bluetooth speaker.
Yeah.
Keep the second mic here.
Okay.
To myself. Pin it to your top. Okay.
Yeah.
Start singing. And the best part is, this has only an audio jack. That's it.
Okay.
You take that audio jack, put it to your phone, you go live from your phone itself.
Okay. Cool.
This is a very, very simple way to go live. What you can do is, for you to control the levels of both the volume, both the
voice and the track.
Voice and this one, just move the mic with the speaker behind. Then the karaoke will be heard less.
Mm-hmm.
Simple. Manually you can do it. You don't need a mixer at all.
Okay. Thank you so much, Kirti. This is very helpful. Thanks for addressing my question.
Sure.
Thanks a lot.
So, okay, Kirti, just two more last questions and we wind up.
Yes.
One question is from Sukanya ma'am. She's asking, how can we use iMovie and other apps to match two or more videos?
Okay. Sukanya ma'am, iMovie, all those things. First of all, we will talk about this in detail in the next class. In the next session, sorry. I'm used to taking dance classes, so I say class, sorry. So we will address these issues in our next session. With respect to creating curated content, we need to record, put it on an editor, produce the video completely, produce the video fully. Only then we put it on our Facebook and Instagram. So that's what, when it comes to iMovie, all of this, that is what it is basically. Right now we are seeing all of these videos online, right? Where there are multiple windows, one veena player plays, then one mridangam artist plays, then one vocalist plays. It is completely produced content. So an editor has actually worked on it. Okay, that is the only way to do it. Okay, I'll give you another example. On the 1st of May, a very, very big concert happened in India. It was called I for India. I don't know, many of you might have even watched it.
Yes.
So I for India. Here, the best of the best musicians from across country, like A.R. Rahman, Harihar and Shankar Mahadevan, they all came and played. Okay. And it was a, in quotes, live event. Okay. It was a live event. What was done was, it was a produced event. All of them were shot, were recorded. The editor has put together the entire thing, and the entire video, it went on for about 3 hours, and they collected about 65 lakhs in aid of COVID relief for artists. Okay, the entire session ran for 3 hours. The entire 3 hour session was produced and then it was sent live on Facebook. We will learn about how to do that in the next session. Okay, so Sukanya ma'am, that's what it is. We'll have to record like, you know, how we record videos. Okay, how we make produce content. We record videos, then through different streaming, third-party streaming platforms, we put it to Facebook, all YouTube and all of that. And we still make it a live event. Just 2 days ago, Ricky Cage had a big concert, which was live on Facebook. That was again done in the same way.
Okay, one last question. This is Padmasini asking us, how long will the premiere stay? I think you already, forever, until you delete it.
Until you delete it, it will stay. No worries about that.
All right, on that note, I think we'll wind up today's session. Thank you all very much. First of all, thank you, Kirti, for doing this very lively and very, I know you piqued our interest. I'm sure a lot of us will go back and we'll start playing around. As you've said, this is such an endless world, and as we speak, things are changing. We are definitely inspired to go back and explore and play around with our devices, with all the things that are there in the digital world. So thank you for this first sort of session on inspiring us.